بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com, your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed Explained from the book Aqidatu Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farsi.
If they say homosexuality is okay and that we should be tolerant because of this, because it is okay, then this is kufr, great kufr. Because it's almost a consensus of Muslim scholars that it is haram. It is definitely haram, not almost consensus, but definitely haram. And it is a consensus of the Muslim scholars, actually. But if they feel that this is not the time to bring up this issue for a certain reason, then that could be true and could be not. But this does not make them kafirs. So the first point makes them kafirs, if they believe it's okay. But the second point makes them at the worst sinners, but not kafirs. And Allah knows best.
The Quran, the Quranic verses say alcohol is haram. A poet writes poetry. He does not say in the poetry that I believe alcohol is haram. He in a way is calling to it. Yeah, yeah. And drinking alcohol is fun. Will make you this. Yeah, yeah, yeah. What is the ruling of this person? The ruling is that he is spreading sin. He'll be more sinning than if he drinks it by himself.
But he is still a Muslim. You cannot call him a kafir.
There's an ayah for that.
Hmm?
Isn't the openly declaring war against the teachings of Islam?
Is it what?
He's not declaring a war against the teachings of Islam.
If he clarifies that, you know, then he is a hypocrite. He's a kafir. You see, alhamdulillah, يعني أهل السنة are very careful about تكفير. You see, شيخ الإسلام محمد بن عبد الوهاب says, I don't declare someone a kafir for what is related to me about him through someone, even if that someone is trustworthy. You see, I only declare him a kafir for something that I myself see and make sure. You see, this is Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab, whom they accuse of takfir. You see, and when he said, I don't declare as a kafir except those who commit something which is shirk, great shirk, and then he said, وَأَكْثَرُ الْأُمَّةُ وَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدُ لَيْسُ كَذَلِكَ. Most of the nation, by the grace of Allah, is not like that. You see. So we say that anyone who supplicates to other than Allah is a mushrik. But if someone comes to us from a country where this thing is done a lot, supplicating to the awliya, we don't go by gesture. We don't say, oh, okay, he's coming from India or from Egypt or this, then he is, must be one of those. No, we don't do this. It doesn't work that way. We have ihsan al-dhan. We have good gesture. So he is a Muslim. Until we see him do this, or we hear him say it's okay, or defend it, or then we declare him a kafir. And we declare him a kafir. Other than that, no. And then this is an apparent issue. So we declare him a kafir if we see him supplicate to other than Allah. But in a hidden issue, like you mentioned, for example, covering the face for the woman, this is a hidden issue. Having a long beard, whether it is from Sunnah or not, this is a hidden issue. Not all people know that this is Sunnah. A lot of people think that this is bad, this is evil, let alone being a Sunnah. You see, they think, oh, why, he doesn't have to do this. He can take from his beard and make it look nice and things like this, you see. So, in this issue, if he says, your beard is like this and this, and he starts making words, you don't call him a kafir here. You have to show him that this is from the Sunnah. You have to establish the proof, you see. These are hidden issues. So we have a distinction between hidden and apparent. We have distinction between calling an action kufr or calling a statement kufr and calling that particular person who is doing it kafir. You see, there are conditions to be met, there are obstacles to be overcome in order for us to call someone a kafir. You see, then there is a distinction between those actions or statements which contradict faith altogether, like prostrating to other than Allah, like supplicating to the awliya, like cussing Allah or his messenger, like stepping on the Quran. These are actions which contradict faith altogether. And if someone does them, he's a kafir. There is no levels in this action. There is no great kufr and small kufr. It's only great kufr. And then we have actions which are called kufr, like ruling, like allegiance, but there are levels. You see, there are levels. So we have a difference. The Khawarij nowadays don't make those distinctions, you see. A small 18-year-old or 15-year-old Khawarij now gives fatwa. He's kafir, he's kafir, he's kafir, this is kafir, he's kafir, this ruler is kafir, that ruler is kafir. Where are you going? This is not your this is not your position to give those fatwas. It's not the position of students of knowledge, let alone your position. As Sheikh Al-Fawzan says, this is not the position of talabatul ilm, students of knowledge, or ansaf al-muta'allimin, half knowledgeable. You see, now we have people who are neither ansaf, half, neither half, neither nor students of knowledge, nothing. They have just read here and there, and they think they know everything. And they declare this kafir and this kafir. And if you differ with them in some issue, you are a kafir. Easy, inshallah. Very easy. Like drinking milk and chocolate.
Prostrating to
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Now, what is the ruling about those actors in movies? They prostrate, they are non-Muslims, but they prostrate to idols. And it's just acting. They don't believe in those idols.
It's kufr, great kufr. They have no excuse to do it.
Because if they had little iman in their heart,
they would not do it. How could someone who glorifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resemble other than Allah to Allah, even if he is not believing? This means he is kafir, no belief.
The outer action showed his
inner action. Yeah, yeah, yeah. An example in Quran, the Jews came to the Arab mushriks and they told them, you are in more guidance than Muhammad. And the Jews knew that those people are idol worshippers. How could they be more guided than Muhammad, who is saying worship one God? They knew it. But since they declared this by their tongue, not in their heart, but only by their tongue, Allah said, يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْجِبْتِ وَالطَّاغُوتِ لَاتْ أَنْ عُزَّةِ. That those Jews believe in Lat and Uzza. They believe in the idols. They did not believe in it in their heart, but by their tongue, they became believers. You see? So actions of kufr cannot be done. If someone does them, he becomes a kafir. The Sheikh goes on in clarifying some misconceptions about ibadah, or in the issues of ibadah, worship. The first important thing is the fact that all worships are based on proofs. The Arabic expression for it is العبادات توقيفية. توقيفية means every worship has to have a proof so that you do it. Otherwise, you stop doing it. توقيفية is from وقف, stop. So if you don't have a proof, you don't do it. Anything that you say in order for you to become closer to Allah or to please Allah, anything to do for that purpose, you have to have a proof for it. If you don't, your obligation is stop and don't do it. Like nowadays, for example, the so-called celebration of the birth date of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the people do it with, let's say, good intention of loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they want to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by showing their love and respect for the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But unfortunately, intention itself is not enough. The worship has to be correct. And if we look in the Quran and Sunnah and the action of the companions who loved the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than anybody else in this nation, we find it very clear that this action was not present at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Neither was it present after his death. As a matter of fact, it was introduced more than 500 years after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when some of the rulers, ignorant rulers, saw that the Christians celebrate the birth of Christ Jesus alayhi salam, and he thought that why not celebrate the birth date of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he started this innovation, and Muslims stuck to that, blind following their scholars until this day. So this is an innovation by the agreement of all Muslim scholars. There is no Sunni scholar who says that celebrating the birth date of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is something which is good or something which you will be rewarded for. As a matter of fact, you will not be rewarded for, and you will be sinning because you are committing an innovation. So this is the meaning of al-ibadat tawqifiyah, or that we have to stop doing anything as a worship to Allah as long as there is no proof from Quran and Sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتَ. Be pious as you have been ordered. So there is no piety in anything which you have not been ordered with by Allah and His Messenger. If you want to be pious, if you want to do a pious action, then it has to be an action which is ordered by Allah or His Messenger. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the true hadith, كل عمل ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. Every action which does not match our action, then it is rejected. And there are similar hadiths in Bukhari and Muslim. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتَ. Be righteous as you have been ordered. وَمَنْ تَابَ مَعَكَ وَلَا تَطْغَوْ. And similarly, those who repent following you, and do not exaggerate or do not exceed the limits. So to do something that you have not been ordered is similar to exceeding the limit. This is very clear in this verse. The Sheikh says this verse has clarified the path, the true path for the Muslim in doing all the worships. That is by being righteous in doing them. That is to doing them in the middle course, in the right course, the course which does not involve any exaggeration or any shortcoming. No exaggerations, no shortcomings. This is the meaning of middle course. In any action, we have to be middle course because we have been described by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be a middle nation. وكذلك جعلناكم أمة وسطا. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be, a middle course. And the middle course means that we have to be right and we have to be doing the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because he was middle course indeed. We cannot make up our own middle points. For example, the Ash'aris claim that they are middle course in matters of aqidah, and they say we are middle between the Mu'tazila, who deny altogether that Allah will be seen on the Day of Judgment, and between those who say that the believers will see Allah by their eyes. They say we are middle course. They are not middle course. They are still deviated towards Mu'tazila. Because the middle course here is that the believers will see Allah by their own eyes. This is the middle course. Allah has said it in Quran, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said it in the Sunnah. Allah has emphasized it in Quran, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned in true hadiths that seeing Allah is a greater pleasure than paradise itself. So how could the middle course be in saying that we will not see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that the believers, both male and female, after meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on Friday in paradise, every Friday, they gain more beauty from seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They gain more beauty, both the males and females, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will expose himself to both men and women in heavens, in paradise. So this is the middle course. But the Ash'aris claim that no one can see him by his own eye. You can see him through his attributes. يعني you can imagine something. Not even imagine the face of Allah or the picture of Allah, no. Because they don't say that Allah has a face altogether. So they claim they are middle course in this, and they are not middle course. This is not, the middle course is not something that you claim. The middle course is that thing which is backed up by the proof from Quran and Sunnah. Qaradawi says he is middle course, and that their way is middle course, and Ikhwan al-Muslimun is middle course. And when we look at their middle course, we find it as far away from the middle course as Mecca is from Washington, or maybe more. What kind of middle course? When he claims that we can love the Christians and Jews, this is not the middle course. The middle course is that you have to hate them, but this hate should not lead you to do injustice to them. You have to be just with them. Hate is something is in the heart, but you cannot harm them. If you see a Christian or a Jew in your country, he has entered with an oath of peace, so you have to respect that oath. You cannot say, because I hate him, I have to do something harmful to him. This is not Islam. So the middle course is that which has been said in Quran and Sunnah. This is the middle course. And the middle course is not what you claim. Qaradawi claims middle course. He says, like our Sheikh Hassan al-Banna said, we have to forget about all differences. As long as our name is Muslim, even if we supplicate to the awliya, to the saints, but our names are is Muslim. So we have to forget all those differences and excuse each other. He's a Sufi, okay, so what? He's a saint worshipper, okay, so what? He is this, he is that. As long as we are called Muslims, our name is Muslim, then we have to excuse each other. This is the middle course, they say. This is the wasatiyya. This is the middle course of Iblis. This is not middle course of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and of Islam. The middle course in Islam is to act upon all the verses and hadiths regarding abandoning the innovator, but in the right way, in the right form. Not also to go to the extreme of some people who, in the name of abandoning the innovator, they do a lot of injustice to people, and they even exaggerate in declaring someone as an innovator, and they declare anyone who differs from them as an innovator, and they treat him not even as an innovator, as a kafir. They treat him as a kafir. So these are extremes. The middle course is to follow the book of Allah and the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to someone, I fast and break my fast, and I pray and I sleep, and I marry women, because those people said, one of them said, I fast and I never break my fast, and the other one said, I pray all nights, every day, I never sleep, and the third one said, I do not marry women, I don't want to waste my time in the responsibilities of marriage, I want to worship Allah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that's not the way I am. I fast and I break also my fast. I pray at night and I sleep also. And I marry women. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as a general rule, he who seeks other than my sunnah, then he is not of me. He who seeks other than my sunnah, then he is not of me. He has nothing to do with me. Narrated by Bukhari and Muslim. Then the Sheikh says, there are now two groups contradicting each other in issues of worship. The first group are the ones who have shortcoming in the matter of worship, and they became lenient in fulfilling their worships until they actually stopped doing a lot of forms of worship, and they only do few things like salat in masjid only, no worship at home, no worship in their workplace, no worship in the stores, no worship on the street, no worship in their dealings, no worship in their politics, no worship in their disputes, and no worship in other aspects of life. So the Sheikh says, of course, there are worships for the masjid, and they have virtues, and they should be done. But the worship includes all the life of the Muslim, inside the mosque and outside the mosque. And then the second group, a group which has, they went too far in applying worships to the degree of being extremists or fundamentalists, as they call them. So they make things which are only desirable, make them an obligation. And they make things which are allowed, make them forbidden. And they declare someone astray if he is different from their way, or if he criticizes their way. And the best course is the course of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the worst evil are the innovations. Then the Sheikh says that the true worship has three pillars. Three pillars. The first is the love, and the second is the fear, and the third is the hope and desire. So, love with submission, fear with hope. They have to be together in worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, describing his worshippers, يُحِبُّهُمْ وَيُحِبُّونَهُ. They love him and he loves them. Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse 54. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. Those who have faith in Allah have more love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 165. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the prophets and messengers, they were going with fast steps in regards to doing good deeds. And they were calling upon us, supplicating to us with desire in our mercy and reward, and fear from our wrath and punishment. And they were submitting to us, or they were in devotion. This is Surah Al-Anbiya, verse 90. Some of our scholars, predecessors, said, he who worships Allah with love alone, then he is zindiq, which is a word synonymous to kafir, and synonymous to being very, very crooked and bad. It's actually not an Arabic word, but it has been used by Arabs to show the great kufr of someone. So they say, he who worships Allah with love alone, meaning that he doesn't fear Allah, he doesn't desire in Allah's mercy, like the Sufis say. We have a lot of Sufis who say this. They say, we don't worship Allah because we want paradise, or because we want reward from him. And we don't stop doing things which are haram because we fear Allah, or because we run away from hellfire. We only do it for the sake of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, this is a big lie, because if the prophets and messengers were as described in the verse that I just recited, they were worshipping Allah out of fear for Allah, and out of desire in his mercy, and out of love also. All three has to be there. So how could those other people claim that they don't fear Allah and they don't desire in his mercy? So they are putting themselves in a position different than the prophets and messengers, which shows that they are not on the right path, because the only right path is the path of the prophets and messengers. And anything which is different, this is not the right path. We have a lot of poetry about so-called Rabi' al-Adawiyya, who was one of the figures of Sufi saints, which say that, oh Allah, I only worship you because I love you, and I don't worship you because I want your paradise, and things like that. We have a lot of poetry like that. But this is wrong, and this is not from Islam. And then those scholars said also, after saying, he who worships Allah with love alone is a zindiq, they said, and he who worships Allah with desire only, then he is a murji. Someone who worships Allah just because Allah is merciful and he will take him to paradise, and he has no care for Allah's punishment at all. He has no fear. He's a murji, because If you lose fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be losing the belief that you will be punished. And if you lose that, then you will dare to do all kinds of sins. And because you will be belittling sins and thinking that any, there is no punishment. So what? So this is irja. This is the great irja. And then they say, وَمَنْ عَبَدَهُ بِالْخَوْفِ وَحْدَهُ فَهُوَ حَرُورِ. And he who worships Allah with fear alone, then he is haruri. This is a name which is synonymous to khariji, haruriyah and khawarij. And of course the khawarij say that anyone who does a great sin, Allah will never forgive him. He will be punished by Allah. And then they went beyond that by considering even any sin to be a great sin, because they said, in any sin, you are disobeying the Almighty, the Great. So this is, يعني, the sin, no matter how small it is, it should be considered great and big. How could you dare to disobey Allah? So the result, the end result was only fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, exaggeration in fear, as if there is no mercy. And this is not Islam. Contrary to what some ignorant Christians claim about Islam, that you Muslims, your belief about Allah, about God, is only that He is Almighty. And He is punishing, a punishing God and a powerful God. This is not true. This is not Islam. The first verse in Quran is in the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most beneficent. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And then the first verse in Quran is Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And mercy is a great praise. Right? Mercy is a great praise, and Muslims believe Allah is all-merciful. Beauty is a great praise, and Muslims believe Allah is the most beautiful. Kindness is a great praise, and Muslims believe Allah is the most kind. Wisdom is a great praise, and Muslims believe Allah is the most wise, and so on. So, Muslims don't only believe that Allah has great punishment, but they believe in a lot of other attributes for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these three pillars that the Shaykh has mentioned are very clear in Surah Al-Fatiha, because Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen involve the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamd in Arabic means love with praise. This is the meaning of Alhamd. Then Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, this involves the desire and His mercy. Because why is Allah telling us about His mercy? To desire it, right? To desire it. And then Maliki Yawm al-Din, why is He threatening us with the Day of Judgment? To fear Him. So those three verses, Alhamdulillah, this is the love. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, this is the mercy. This is the desire in Allah's mercy. Maliki Yawm al-Din, this is the fear of His punishment. And then right after that, Allah says, Iyyaka na'bud. So after mentioning those three pillars, Allah says, Iyyaka na'bud. It is you whom we worship alone. So worship is based on those three pillars together. They have to be together. You say them in every rak'ah. No prayer will be accepted without saying those three verses and the rest of Surah Al-Fatiha, of course. Then the Shaykh says that this quote that we mentioned about some of the Salaf was mentioned by Shaykh al-Islam in his book Al-Ubudiyyah. And he also quotes Shaykh al-Islam as saying that the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is both worshipping Him and obeying Him and submitting to Him, and that worship, the bottom line meaning of worship, the bottom line meaning of worship is submission. Like you say, this is a submissive path or a submissive street or a submissive way to show that it is smooth and easy. And the worship which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us with includes the submission and humility, that we have to submit in humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in humbleness. Humility means humbleness. And also there has to be love. If you only submit yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without loving Him, you are not worshipping Him. If someone does things for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just because he thinks he has to submit to Allah without loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is not worship. This is not worship. And this is just like the one who thinks the opposite, who thinks that worship means to love Allah. And we have a lot of ignorance nowadays who have this belief. Yani when you tell them, why don't you pray? Why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? Why don't you do that? They say, well, yani, we love Allah. We have faith in our hearts. We love Allah, or something like that. This is false, a false love. How could you claim loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you are not doing the least to please Him? You are not doing the least to please Him, and you say you love Him? This is a very false claim. If you were loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would be doing your best to please Him. So these are the foundations of worship. Then the Sheikh goes into a different topic, and that is the topic of names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, we will do it in another time. Regarding this topic, legislation, of course, the Sheikh has said in this book, his book At-Tawheed, that anyone who gives himself the right to legislate, then he is setting himself as a rival to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he also mentioned in this book that to rule with man-made law is great kufr, which takes someone out of Islam. If someone substitutes the Sharia with a man-made law, then he is a kafir. But the Sheikh was asked about certain rulers by name, rulers of such and such country, and the Sheikh said, I don't declare them kafirs, even though they are ruling with man-made law. I don't declare them kafirs until I know the full detail of their situation. This is a very important thing. And another thing that he added is, after saying this, he said, is it maslaha to declare they are kafirs? Which is another barrier that the most of the enthusiastic youth don't understand. Yani first, there is the barrier of declaring someone in particular as kafir, some ruler in particular. This is not like declaring in general that anyone who rules with other than the rule of Allah, or anyone who substitutes the rule of Allah with some man-made law, is a kafir. This is true. Substitution of Allah's legislation with man-made law is great kufr. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, when he mentioned the kinds of judges, he said, the second kind is the judge which rules with other than the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to achieve certain worldly gains, and he is indeed deserving punishment by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But, he said, but this is when speaking about someone who does such an action in one or two issues. But if someone makes a general legislation in which he makes the haram halal, or the haram halal, or the sunnah bid'ah, and the bid'ah sunnah, then he said, Shaykh al-Islam says, هذا أمر آخر يحكم فيه رب العالمين. This is a different situation. This is a different matter in which Allah alone rules regarding that person. So we notice in this distinction two things, Shaykh al-Islam. First, he made a distinction between the situation in which someone, whether a judge or a ruler, rules in a wrong way, knowing that he's doing wrong, admitting that he's doing wrong, but he does it for some worldly gain. He's a sinner, indeed. That's why the Sheikh said he is threatened by punishment, because he's a sinner. And the second thing is the saying of the Sheikh, يحكم فيه رب العالمين, that that particular person, when he makes a legislation, then whether he is a kafir or not, this depends on whether the يعني conditions apply to him completely, and there are no obstacles regarding not calling him a kafir or calling him a kafir. We have توفر الشروط وانتفاء الموانع. The conditions have to be satisfied, and the obstacles have to be removed in order for us to call someone in particular as a kafir. This is the duty of the scholar. And then the third point that Sheikh Al-Fawzan mentioned is there maslaha in declaring him as a kafir after knowing that he is a kafir? Should we declare him as a kafir? What are the outcomes? What are the advantages and disadvantages? If someone says, we have to care less about this, then he doesn't know Islam. Then he's a fool. He's a stooge. He better sit in his house and take care as much as he can of himself and his children, and not do anything else, because he is a man who will do corruption in the name of Islam. So the scholars only decide that this ruler in particular deserves the title of kufr, and then it's only the scholars who decide when to declare him a kafir, because there are a lot of outcomes which are going to result from declaring him a kafir. It is not something that is only for this man, for the ruler. No, there are a lot of things involved here. Bloodshedding and a lot of things are involved. That's why Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, even though he considered the statement of saying Al-Qur'anu makhluq to be a great kufr, Imam Ahmad considered anyone who says lafzi bil-Qur'an makhluq is a kafir. So how about anyone who says Al-Qur'anu makhluq? Lafzi bil-Qur'an makhluq is a much less kufr, but he declared him as a kafir. Yet he did not declare the rulers who were punishing him and torturing him to say that Quran is created. Not only they were saying Quran is created, they were punishing anyone who doesn't say it, They were torturing the scholars who were not saying it. They were forcing them to say it. They were using their army and police to capture everyone who doesn't say it. They were using the prisons to punish those who don't say this kufr. And despite all that, Imam Ahmad rahimahullah was making dua for them. He strongly opposed revolting against them or fighting them by force. When his students came to him asking him permission that we should revolt against those people, that it's very clear they are saying something kufr, he said, no. La. هذا خلاف الآثار, he says. This is against the true hadiths, to go against them by force. Then he said, إنها الدماء, إنها الدماء, إنها الدماء. This is going to be involving bloodshed. This is going to be involving bloodshed. This is going to be involving bloodshed. It's not an easy issue. Who is responsible for the bloodshed of Muslims? Who is responsible for this? He is fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not like those stooges nowadays who give orders, go and kill, go and do this and do that, make explosions here, make explosions that. Inshallah, you are a martyr. Inshallah, you are a shaheed. Maybe they are saying this when they are eating hummus and something else. They care less. They don't know what they are doing. No fear from Allah, no piety, nothing. Just go and do it. Abu Qatada, the Palestinian, he was giving fatwas to those who were killing children in Algiers, Muslim children. And he, careless. Yani because they think that this is their only way to stop the government from capturing them and doing this and that. So this is the point regarding the legislation that Sheikh Al-Fawzan, rahimahullah, hafizahullah and rahimahullah, because mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is necessary for us while we are alive and when we become dead, is making it very clear that if we say that ruling with other than the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is kufr, or if we say that ruling with a man-made legislation is kufr, that doesn't necessarily mean that this ruler in particular is a kafir. This issue is very clear. And then even if we declare he's a kafir, we have to see the maslaha, the advantages and disadvantages of declaring him as a kafir. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد. الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم, وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن نبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله. The topic today inshallah from the book of Tawheed by the Honorable Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan is about a great aspect, and that is one of the divisions of Tawheed, and that is the Tawheed of Asma wa Sifat, the Tawheed regarding the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Sheikh divides the subject into three topics. First, the proofs from Quran and Sunnah and from the true thought and logic in proving the names and attributes for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And second is the methodology of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah in regarding the names of Allah and His attributes. And thirdly, refuting on those who deny names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or deny it partially. Because the deniers are two kinds. One kind are those who deny all the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the other kind are those who approve some of the attributes of Allah but deny, whether directly or indirectly, most of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First, the Shaykh starts with the proofs from Quran and Sunnah and from the true logic and thought. He starts with the proofs from Quran and Sunnah. The Shaykh says, we mentioned earlier in this book that Tawheed is divided into three types: Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, Tawheed al-Asma'i wa-Sifat. Then the Shaykh goes on regarding proofs of Tawheed al-Asma'i wa-Sifat. He quotes the verse which is very direct and clear: وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا وَذَرُوا الَّذِينَ يُلْحِدُونَ فِي أَسْمَائِهِ سَيُجْزَوْنَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى, to Allah belong all the beautiful names. فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا, so supplicate to him with those names. وَذَرُوا الَّذِينَ يُلْحِدُونَ فِي أَسْمَائِهِ, and be aware, stay away from those who commit deviation in regards to the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who deviate in regards to the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this deviation, ilhad, can take any form. Scholars have mentioned several forms, and if the Shaykh does not mention them, then inshallah later on I will mention them. The Shaykh says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stated clearly, approving for himself the names, and that those names are described by Husna. Husna is a word which is stronger than Hasan, because it is the plural of Ahsan, not the plural of Hasan. Hasan means beautiful, and Ahsan means the most beautiful. So the plural of Hasan is Hisan, and the plural of Ahsan is Husna. So this is a more fit description for the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most beautiful names. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to supplicate to him by those names. That is, we say, O Allah, O Rahman, O Rahim, O Hay, O Qayyum, and so on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has threatened those who deviate in regards to the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And ilhad is an Arabic word which means deviation. That's why the deviated hole in the grave for the deceased person is not straight, it is inclined. So that's called lahd, the thing that they make for the dead in his grave. It's called lahd because it's deviated, it's inclined. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbid us from any form of deviation in regards to his names and attributes. The Shaykh says this deviation is either by denying those names of Allah or by explaining them in a manner which changes the true meaning of those names and attributes, or any other kind of deviation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is threatening those who fall into it. Now, since the Shaykh did not mention those types of ilhad, they are actually five types of ilhad in regards to the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first is the denial of those names and attributes, whether it is total denial of all the names and attributes like the Jahmiya and Mu'tazila do, with a distinction, of course, the Jahmiya do not approve of any names and attributes. The Mu'tazila claim that they approve of the names but not the attributes, no meanings for those names, which is contradictory and which leads to the same madhab of Jahmiya actually. Or partial denial, like the Ash'aris and Maturidis. They are abundant in the Indian continent and in Africa and Egypt and many other places, like Al-Azhar Institution and many other places. They have those two aqidas, Al-Ash'ariya and Al-Maturidiyya. Maturidiyya is mostly in the Indian continent because the Hanafis are Maturidis with very few Ash'aris. But in Egypt and in Africa and some other places, mostly Ash'aris. So they have partial denial of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Actually, they deny most of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But still, they are better than Jahmiya and Mu'tazila because at least they approve of some of those attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second type of ilhad is to resemble the names and attributes of Allah to the names and attributes of His creatures. To say that Allah has a hand like our hand, or He has eyes like our eyes. This is also ilhad. This is also a deviation. Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah indeed say that Allah has two hands, but they say not like the hands of His creatures. And they don't allow anyone to qualify them, that is to describe their quality, that is to describe how they are, that is to go into the true nature, because this is unknown to us. This is unknown to us. This is unseen. This is unknown to us. So we only approve of what Allah have said about Himself, that He has two hands. But we do not say how they are, and we do not imagine, because there is no way to imagine anything about the reality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the sights which can see things around cannot see Allah, then how about the brain which is inside and the heart which is inside? There is no way to encompass Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or to imagine anything regarding the true nature or the true essence of Allah or His attributes. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, لا تدركه الأبصار. No sights can encompass Him. And that is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا تفكروا في الله وتفكروا في آلائه. Do not think about how Allah's essence is and how Allah's attributes are. Do not think about Allah in this way. This is haram because this leads nowhere. And it could only lead to deviation and maybe kufr. That's why we are ordered not to think about the nature or the reality of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا تضربوا لله الأمثال. Do not set up examples for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because there is no example of Him. Unlike the Christians who claim that Allah has sent His Son to the earth, we Muslims claim that Jesus was only a human being who was created from the same material as all other humans, and His soul was blown into Mary by the angel, and that He was a human being. He had no relationship with God. Of course, He was a messenger of God. He was an honorable messenger of God. The third type of ilhad is to name Allah with some name that Allah did not name Himself with. like the Christians call him the father, and like the philosophers call him the brain or something like that, and like the Ash'aris who call him Al-Qadim. Al-Qadim is not a name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, the fourth kind of ilhad is to describe Allah with something that he did not describe himself with. And that is like what the Jews say about Allah, that he got tired and he rested, and that he wrestled with Jacob and Jacob overcome him and something like that. We seek refuge in Allah from their kufr. And the fifth type of ilhad is to derive a name for a false god from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like Al-Lat, the idol that the Arabs used to worship. Some say that Al-Lat is from Al-Ilah, and Al-Uzza from Al-Aziz, and Manat from Al-Mannan. So this is also a kind of ilhad, a deviation. So these are the five types. The Sheikh did not mention them here, maybe because he might have mentioned them somewhere else. Allah knows best. Then he brings another verse. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa lahu al-asma'ul husna. That Allah is the only one who is worthy of being worshipped, and that he has the most beautiful names. To him belong the most beautiful names. Huwa Allahu alladhi la ilaha illa huwa alimul ghaybi wash-shahada. It is him, or it is he, Allah, no one worthy of being worshipped but him, the knower of the unseen and the present. He is the all-merciful, the all-beneficent. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن and so on. This is verse 24, Surah Al-Hashr, 22-24. Some of his names and attributes are mentioned here. Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Al-Salam, Al-Mu'min, Al-Muhaymin, and so on. And this is the way of Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises himself, he praises himself in detail. Al-Malik is one praise. Al-Quddus, Al-Mu'min, Al-Salam, Al-Muhaymin, Al-Aziz, Al-Jabbar, Al-Mutakabbir, and so on. So this is the way of Quran. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala glorifies himself, he makes a general statement like لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing like him. This is to say that he has no deficiency. We don't have to say those deficiencies. It is enough to say that no deficiency belongs to him. We don't have to quote them. Similarly, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. So it's only one statement. This is the way of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. When it comes to praising Allah, they go in detail and mention all the praises, all the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when it comes to glorifying Allah, they say statements which are general but inclusive of denying all the deficiencies about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the way of Quran, and this is the way of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. That is why you can find a book regarding this topic which is only 20 pages or 15 pages, and it's more than enough. It is more than enough. And when you go to the innovators, you find them do the opposite exactly. When it comes to praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they put general statements. And they don't put the praises in detail because, as we mentioned earlier, the total deniers, they don't approve any attribute of Allah. So what can they put? And the partial deniers only approve some attributes, so few attributes. And then, not only that, they don't put any verses or hadiths because they don't believe that the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be taken from the verses and hadiths. They say that they should be derived from the thought only. Whatever their minds can imagine to be an attribute for Allah, they put it as an attribute and they declare it as an attribute. Otherwise, they say no. And in regarding to denying the deficiencies about Allah, they go into hundreds of pages of details from their minds, not from the Book of Allah, not from the Sunnah of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And if you read those hundreds of pages, you come out semi-crazy. You come out with a lot of doubts in your hearts. They say Allah is neither inside this world nor outside this world. So what does this statement benefit? It benefits nothing but contradiction. Because when they say he is neither in this world nor in this world, that equals non-existence. That is synonymous that to the fact that Allah is non-existing. And then they say he is not up, neither down, nor to the right, nor to the left, nor to this way, nor that way, nor this way. Because they don't believe that actually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a true being and has true attributes, and that he is above his throne and his throne is above all heavens. They don't believe in that. That's why to them it is not only unlawful to point to the heavens when you say Allah is there, but it is kufr to them. They consider this to be a rejection of faith. And when you read their books about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's all nays, nays. Allah is not this, not that, not this, not that, not this, not that, not this, not that, and you go crazy. Because they say, as I mentioned earlier, he is neither inside this world nor outside this world. And then they say he is neither this and nor that. And this and that are contradictory. So he is neither this nor that. So he's nothing. So if you go by their definitions, only with one or two definitions, you become an atheist. Because their definitions means Allah does not exist. Their definitions mean Allah is nothing. So you become an atheist. That is why Jahm ibn Safwan became an atheist truly, declared atheism for 40 days, and he stopped praying because he said, there is no God. Jahm ibn Safwan. And this is, of course, the way of the innovators. But as the Sheikh is mentioning, the way of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah is to follow the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding the names and attributes of Allah. And this is the way of the companions, and this is the way of the students of the companions, and this is the way of the four imams.